Hello and welcome to the next edition of the Weikert Report's video blog. My name is Brandon Weikert, founder and CEO of the Weikert Report. I'd like to talk to you today a little bit about or continuing the conversation that we've been having since the Weikert Report was founded in May of 2016. On the issue of populist movements, nationalism, anti-globalization, what have you. This movement is obviously, it's an organic, bottoms-up movement. It's a response, it's a reaction. It's not a revolution per se in the sense that it is seeking to undo the existing order and replacing it with something unknown or never before experienced. Quite the contrary, it's seeking a kind of return in most cases to something more fundamental, elemental in each one of these countries and throughout the world. So one of the things that I have been striving to outline in my analysis of each individual kind of populist movement, of both left and right, what I've been trying to understand, whether it's the movements in Western Europe that are most talked about, the kind of quote-unquote alt-right movements, whether it's the rise of Donald Trump in the United States, or less known things. So, for instance, what's going on in China? Could it potentially collapse? Is Russia going to stay with us, or are they going to collapse, as many popular commentators have been speculating for years now? I'm trying to understand what is kind of this unifying. Is there anything holding these groups together in the sense that is there a theme that plays out? Other than just, oh, we don't like globalization, or, oh, we don't, you know, we want more power to the people. That's obviously always a part of it. But there's something more here. And so for the last several months, I've been at the Weikert Report trying to figure it out. And I think that the best way to synthesize it is to simply say that this is a reaction on the part of people, ordinary people, those who, whether their countries were involved in globalization or not, most of these people that are in the movement, a vast majority of the populations, were people who did not have direct, tangible benefits from the last 30 years of globalization. And so they're responding, though, specifically less to globalization as an economic force and less to, you know, the increase in kind of oligarchy, for instance, in the West, as many of them would say, has happened with the so-called global elites, the coastal elites, as we call them in the United States. And more to do with just a basic belief that internal government or internal state failure has occurred. And what I mean by that term, internal state failure, the failure of governance in each individual country. What I mean by that is the fact that these movements are reacting to internal forces. They are predominantly demographic, cultural, political, and then economic. Taken together, that's what this global reaction, global nationalist reaction has been all about. And you're seeing the response on the part of the governed, you know, we the people throughout the world. This is a very visceral reaction to the breakdown in the social contract between the governed and those who do the governing. In the United States and in Western Europe, you're having this interesting paradigm play out where the accepted paradigm, governing paradigm, of the kind of social democratic variant of governance in the case of Western Europe, and kind of this quasi, you know, neoliberal, to use a technical term, style of governance in America, or basically an acceptance of an administrative state, an acceptance of a welfare state for the last 70 years now since FDR, you're seeing people responding negatively because that which they took for granted is no longer being conferred upon them. So basically, the basic social contract between those who do the governing and those who are governed has broken down, at least in the eyes of most people. And this is a theme that is that we have seen kind of disparate analyses of over the last decade. For instance, I'm forgetting the name now. I will have it linked though in the in the section when I post the video. But basically, the group that studies global violence trends, and they found that while generally speaking, global violent trends have declined, and Steven Pinker analyzes this a lot in his works. Global violent trends have declined, yes, and they've continued to for the most part. In fact, internal state, internal violence within a state, as opposed to external interstate violence, you know, nations fighting and the like, but internal violence has actually increased. And I think this is a direct response to the breakdown of, or the perceived breakdown of, the social contract. So in America, you know, the big three entitlements, Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid, are no longer paying out what they used to pay out. There is no real alternative being proffered. People are scared of losing those entitlements. You've got also the fact that most people haven't experienced a pay raise in over a decade. That's commiserate with inflation. Most people have been toiling, frankly, and then 2008, really, the recession really laid that out for all to see. And this is something similar going on in Western Europe. If you look at Marine Le Pen, for instance, as I've documented here on the Weichert Report, if you look at Marine Le Pen and the Le Pen Party, the National Front Party, they are a right-wing party and they are populist, but they're not, unlike Fillon and the more conventional Republicans over there, the more conventional right-of-center party there, they're not advocating for reforming or reducing France's very generous welfare state. What they're talking about is limiting access to non-citizens, to immigrants of France. They're talking about preserving it. And Donald Trump in America ran on a similar platform. He didn't talk about embracing the kind of Paul Ryan vision for entitlement reform. He didn't talk about these things that we take for granted, as you know, that many conservative intellectuals take for granted, and that we take for granted in the public as being kind of a preferred right-wing talking point. That has been thrown out the window. It's much more populist. So it accepts that people expect their government to do X, Y, and Z, and it's that people believe that the government's no longer doing it, even as those who do the governing and, you know, big businesses and academics continue to reap the benefits. I was recently interviewed by Patrick Johnson over at the Christian Science Monitor, and he was asking me about a piece I wrote back in November on AmericanGreatness.com. You should all go check it out. It was a comparison piece between how basically Trump was the Republicans' FDR, and that was a good thing. And he was asking me, and something that I said to him that was included in the article on Christian Science Monitor was that most of the elites, both Republican and Democrat, they find President Trump's speech his inaugural address, for instance, at quote-unquote dark. Well, the reason that it seems that way is because to them, and I know I live among them, I live in the Washington, D.C. area, so I live with them. To people out in these areas, life's great, never been better. It's very worth noting that inside the Beltway, Washington, D.C., as the rest of America and indeed the world was suffering economically, most Washingtonians, the home prices really didn't, you know, they were affected, but most of the home prices stayed relatively, it was still a profitable industry. People were still buying and selling like they were before the recession. It was a little, the Beltway became a little enclave of prosperity in a sea of recession. And so that is kind of a microcosm, a snapshot of what is driving this thing. It's the failure of the social contract, the perceived failure of the social contract. And each, look at the Arab Spring. Look at the Arab Spring, not just in the West. Look at the Arab Spring. If you place the Arab Spring into the larger context of this long-running, and I mean long-running, going back 30, 40 years, of a long-running global reaction to globalization, to the failure of social contracts in each country, what happened in the Arab Spring? Well, the Arab Spring in the Sunni world, predominantly, was the response on the part of the governed, who no longer believed that secular autocrats were delivering the goods, and they were tired of it. Now, unfortunately, in many cases, the people ended up putting in the best organized and the most familiar groups. So that was why Islamists, in the case of the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, ended up winning the day. And that was why that was such a threat to American foreign policy and overall national security. And also, frankly, replacing secular autocrats with religious totalitarians is not good for anyone, especially those who will be directly governed by them. Just ask anyone who lived under the Taliban rule in Afghanistan or who is currently living under the ISIS rule in the Middle East. Pardon me. And if you look at Iran, what's Iran? Iran in 2009, the Green Revolution, failed one, was mostly young people. The young people of Iran are very liberal. They're very secular compared to their elders. They are mostly pro-West, or at least Western-friendly. They came out against what they perceived as a failure of the Iranian government, the Islamic Republic of Iran, the Shiite-led, the modest government of Iran. And they attempted to overthrow it. Now, the Obama administration did not do anything substantive to encourage them. In fact, because the Obama administration was desperate to make this nuclear deal from day one, they ended up basically giving carte blanche to the Ayatollah and the Mullah Council to crack down, which is exactly what they did. But make no mistake, in Iran, the Shiite response for most people, especially among the young, was a truly pro-democratic movement that sought to undo what they perceived as a failed government, the current governing structure. They wanted to undo it. And the reason they did that is because since 1979, they've lived under an Islamist theocracy, and they don't like it. Unfortunately for the Sunni world, they're basically where Iran was in 1979. And so my concern is that many of these Sunni secular autocracies are going to have to, not have to be, but they will be overthrown by this populist surge. And unfortunately, they may place Islamist governments. That's where my friend Nathan Fields, he posted an article on the Weicker Report 2 or 3 weeks ago in which he advocated for Tom Barak, who is a senior Trump advisor. He basically agreed with Tom Barak's stance that we should be doing some type of economic aid, basically not aid, but like a trade to build up indigenous industries for the tune of a few billion dollars, which is a drop in the bucket compared to how much we spend on military operations in the Mideast, that could actually go a very long way in shoring up the popular support for the West and for more secular, less radical movements among the young in the Middle East, who are the most likely to be radicalized at this point. If you shift over to China, you have, as I've noted in other articles, you have the Chinese people are in Hong Kong. The Hong Kongers are rabidly opposed to the Beijing government under Xi Jinping. They have elected, as of 2016, the most anti-China, pro-Hong Kong legislature in their history since being taken over by China in 1997. They are responding negatively to attempts on the part of Xi Jinping to intensify Chinese control. As I've noted in other articles on the Weicker Report, Xi Jinping is trying to basically redo Hong Kong law, which is a very advanced legal system that is predicated on English law, which is frankly the most effective law for doing business, for international trade, which is Hong Kong, that's what it is, it's a hub of international trade. Beijing is trying to impose Chinese law upon this predominantly British, English model legal system, which is causing all kinds of problems, not just politically, but also for the international business interests in Hong Kong. Taiwan is going to suffer under the ire of this kind of move on the part of the Chinese government to shore up its holdings, and I think ultimately it's going to fail in much the same way that the elites, the entrenched elites in America, in Western Europe, in the Middle East, are either failing or have failed or will fail. You cannot fight this wave. Now, not every populist movement is going to be successful, but they're going to make significant gains, and it's going to set them up for further gains. You see, this is not going to happen overnight. Take, for instance, what's going on in Romania. What's going on in Romania is a movement called the Union to Save Romania, which is a left-wing movement started by a mathematician. Was created in response to what they perceived as overwhelming corruption from the government. And they were considered a fringe movement, not unlike Le Pen's movement in France or the Alternative for Deutschland movement in Germany, which we have followed extensively at the Weichert Report, or not unlike the Trump movement in America, or not even unlike what I believe to be a significant movement, for burgeoning movement, the Wild Rose Party in Alberta, Canada. So you have the Union to Save Romania, and while they certainly in the last election did not have significantly, they didn't become the dominant party, and they didn't become number two, but they actually became number three, which is a very big deal for a party that was considered ultra fringe. And I believe that they're in the next election cycle in Romania, if trends persist, I believe they will continue to see gains because they are anti-corruption, pro-government efficiency, and in this case, they're center-left, which is good for Romania's political structure. That's how they prefer things over there. It's a very interesting paradigm that you're having here. It's not going away. It's going to continue and continue and continue. And groups like AfD in Germany, yeah, they're number three now. I believe they're number two now. But they started out as number three, a distant third, and now they've become number two. It's this movement, slow movement in the Tea Party in America, which is also, I believe, the Trump movement. Same thing. They started out, and I'm telling you, if you look at, for instance, Dave Bratt's win in Virginia, displacing Eric Cantor in 2014, you're going to see more and more stuff like that happening, and the longer that these trends persist, because the internal failure of governance is not going to go away. The social contract has completely broken down in most states, or is on the path of completely breaking down in other states. And this isn't, so there's going to be significant changes. And my advice here is to keep watching my vlogs, keep reading my website, keep reading American Greatness, keep watching out for me in interviews, because this is a trend that I am tracking. I've been tracking for a while now, and it's not going away. And so there's still money to be had. You know, Ian Bremmer, who is somebody I respect, he's a very brilliant guy, but he's, I think, misses the forest for the trees, because he is of the globalist mentality. And so when he talks about the G0 world in his book, and when he identifies these kind of negative, he looks at the same pattern that I'm looking at, and he sees nothing but consternation, because he says, you know, nothing's going to get done. Well, if you look at the world through a globalist's multilateral worldview, yeah, multilateral organizations are going to get hit really hard in this new world. Yeah, you know, international organizations like the UN are really not going to do well in this period. But that doesn't mean that nothing's going to get done. That doesn't mean that we're all going to self-isolate and push away. No. What it means is that you're going to have countries become internally focused, that may at times lead to hostile action, that may at times even lead to trade war. That doesn't mean, though, that we're going, you know, into isolationist mode. What it means is that it's going to take leaders who have a more pre-Cold War, pre-World War II view on state interaction and power, a more kind of realpolitik or machtpolitik, if, you know, depending on how you want to look at it, but basically where it's going to be a greater focus on bilateral state-to-state relations as opposed to multilateral relations. So, for instance, if America under President Trump thinks that it can get a good trade deal going for a certain, you know, whatever, and it looks around the world, who can we do business with? Well, Britain. Okay, well, let's offer this deal to Britain, Theresa May, and we will do a direct special agreement with trading deal with Britain, as opposed to going through the EU, which, of course, Britain is no longer a part of, as opposed to going through the EU and going through all of these multilateral institutions. Then we have to go through the customs union, and then we have to hopefully get past the external tariff. Well, we go directly to the source. We go, hey, look, we've got X, Y, and Z. We want to trade you for you know, ABC. Let's get together. And that's how it's going to be. This is how the world, by the way, operated for most of existence after the Treaty of Westphalia, which created the modern nation state system after the 30 Years' War in, what, 1649, I believe. This is how things have gone on for a while. It's just the last 60 years or so we've had this kind of international globalist perspective. And it's not that America's going to... Actually, I think America's going to probably be the best suited for dominating this kind of world in terms of trade and getting things done, because the world is going to favor the largest, most unified states. And for regardless of all of the garbage going on in America's domestic political system right now, with the rioting and the, you know, the hate speech and all the, you know, craziness, America is still America, and we're going to remain united, and we are going to continue going on the kind of unified trajectory that we've been on for the last 200 plus years. And in that world, America's global reach is going to be more important than ever, because the EU is going to decline and eventually collapse. Russia is not going to be strong enough. China is going to collapse. And so really what you're going to have is an American-led world again. You know, I don't mean to take I don't mean to take someone else's line, but the 21st century, I think, is shaping up to be both a G0 kind of a world with Ian Bremmer's viewpoint, but it's also going to be much more positive than people like Ian Bremmer talk about, because in the G0 mentality, the multilateral organizations, international organizations, are not going to be as effective, but individual states will. And the flexibility of individual states will be vital. And America is a very flexible country in terms of diplomatic agreements and whatnot, particularly under innovative leadership. And so I think that 21st century is going to shape up to be the next second American century. I think that in the long run, we are best suited to dominate in that kind of an environment. So there's going to be a lot of opportunities, I'm going to be tracking this. We're getting our next phase of the website underway. I'm looking at potentially reorganizing the website, so you may see some changes to the theme of the website in terms of the way it looks. Keep an eye out for that. But we're really getting close now. I've been doing for the last several months deep research on key issues. I'm going to be publishing soon our first electronic booklet that will be for sale, and it will give you kind of greater insight. But stay with the Weikert Report, because we're the only ones in town talking about this accurately, talking about this fairly. We don't shut out sources because we don't agree politically with them. We look at them and we actually research and check what certain sources that may not be as well known as some of the other mainstream websites or some of the other mainstream publications. We actually look at what they say and we check it against, you know, what we know, what I know, and people that we can rely on in the field who can communicate with us and tell us, no, this is right, this is wrong. So just keep an eye out, because we're going to also start talking a lot about, I'd like to get on talking about investments, how we can be investing in this kind of a world and how you could make some money, and just how we're going to be kind of working on these trends. So keep an eye out for us. This is the first of many new vlogs. So thank you so much for the Weikert Report. I'm Brandon Weikert, and this is your world. It's going to be fun.